Welcome to virtual worship at Trinity Lutheran Church. This is the worship service for Sunday, March 21st, 2021, the fifth Sunday in Lent. Next week, March 28th, is Palm Sunday, and we will gather here at Trinity outside. If it's a nice day, we'll get out of our cars and do what we did last summer and last fall, and you can sit on the parking lot, sit on the lawn. If it's not such a nice day, people can just stay in their cars. And of course, even if some people do choose to get out, you're welcome to stay in your car. We're hoping to get a good number of us together to celebrate. And if we did it inside, numbers would be really restricted still. But if we do it outside, we can have a big gathering. And so we will do the same for Easter on April 4th. We hope to have a good turnout and a beautiful day to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. We'll keep you up to date about the possibilities of gathering for indoor worship. When the pandemic started, council made the decision that we wouldn't have indoor worship when Vernon was in the orange or the red COVID alert zone, when infection rates were on the higher side. So we're waiting for infection rates to come down. I realize that Governor Lamont, as of the 19th of March, has said that we don't have a whole lot of restrictions anymore. We are choosing to follow the advice of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America and the New England Synod and be more cautious. The day is coming very soon when most of us are either going to be vaccinated or the infection rate is going to be really low, and we're just waiting for that day when it will be even safer for us to get together. We have had no instances of COVID transmission at Trinity Lutheran Church, and we want to keep it that way. If you have any questions or concerns, please feel free to send me an email or give me a call. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes. Darkest water and deepest pain, I wouldn't trade it for anything, cause my brokenness brought me to you. These wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for. Standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness, and I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear.
going to say? Should we continue sinning so grace will multiply? Absolutely not. All of us died to sin. How can we still live in it? Or don't you know that all who were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried together with him through the baptism into his death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too can walk into newness of life. If we were united together in a death like his, we will also be united together in a resurrection like his. This is what we know. The person who used to be was crucified with him in order to get rid of the corpse that had been controlled by sin. That way we wouldn't be slaves to sin anymore, because a person who has died has been freed from sin's power. But if we died with Christ, we have faith that we will also live with him. We know that Christ has been raised from the dead. He will never die again. Death no longer has power over him. He died to sin once and for all with his death, but he lives with God with his life. In the same way, you should also consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive for God and Jesus Christ. So then, don't let sin rule your body, so that you do what it wants. Don't offer parts of your body to sin, to be used as weapons to do wrong. Instead, present yourselves to God as people who have been brought back to life from the dead, and offer all your parts of your body to God to be used as weapons to do right. Sin will have no power over you, because you aren't under law, but under grace. This ends the reading.
Hello, young people. We are continuing our talks as we move through Lent about the death of Jesus and what it means for us. And we talked about a lot of different ways that the Bible explains the meaning of Jesus' death and what Jesus was doing when he was on the cross. Today, there's a different view that St. Paul gives us, a kind of another explanation for what Jesus was doing for us. And what Paul says is that we are united. We're together with Jesus in dying and in being raised to new life. And that might be a hard thing for us to understand, but for the early Christians, the image, that thought probably worked a lot better. Because in the early church, the people that were getting baptized were older people, mostly adults. And the way that they would get baptized is they would be plunged down into the water, their heads under the water, and then they come back up, kind of like dying and coming back to life. If you've ever been underwater and you're underwater and you can't breathe, and then you come back up out of the water and you take that big breath of air, it feels pretty good. And Paul is saying that when we're baptized, we're tied in together with the death and resurrection of Jesus. And what that means for us is that we have the life of Jesus inside us. And because we have that life of Jesus inside us, we are enabled to love other people, to care for other people even more than we would be otherwise. And so Paul says, one of the things that happened on the cross is that Jesus shared his life with us. That those of us that follow Jesus have Jesus' life inside us. That because we're baptized, that makes us sons and daughters, children of God, just like Jesus is the Son of God. That we're that close to God, and we, with God's blessing, could go out into the world and be a blessing to other people. I pray that you're all doing well, and again, I continue to look forward to that day when we'll get back together. I do miss you, and I know that we will get back together again. God bless you. As we're working our way through Lent, we are continuing to look at the metaphors that the Bible uses to describe the atonement, what the meaning and effect of Jesus' death on the cross is for us as individuals, for all of humanity, and really for all of creation. Because the Bible says that Jesus' death is really a turning point in the whole history of the world. That event demonstrates God's love in a profound and life-changing way, in a world-changing way. And it's such a big event and such a profound event that when we talk about it, well, even when the Bible talks about it, it talks about the cross with metaphors. And that's what we've been saying over the course of this series during Lent, that the Bible uses metaphors. Now, the Bible uses a lot of metaphors to describe God, to describe heaven, to describe all kinds of aspects of reality. We just need to realize that that's what's happening. A metaphor, as you all know, is when we say that one thing is another thing, even though we know that it is not literally true. So it's when we say, for example, you know, we're all missing the kids and coming together for a worship service and having, you know, having the kids around, you know, seeing one another. I mean, I think we all miss the kids a certain amount because they bring joy, you know. So we would say something like, Evie Becker is a ray of sunshine. Her smile lights up the room. Now, we know that Evie is not literally a bunch of photons flying through space. She's not literally light. And if you put her in a dark room and turned off all the lights and had all the shades down and she smiled, light would not come out of her teeth to light up the room. We know that these things are not literally true. But we also know that they do communicate truth. They communicate something that is real, an experience that is real. And likewise, when the Bible uses metaphors, it uses those metaphors to communicate something that is profoundly true. And so when Jesus says that he came to give his life a ransom for many, that communicates a profound change in our status, that we have access to freedom that we didn't have before. That Jesus' death makes us different. It changes who we are. Now, again, as I've said many times, you can't push the metaphor too far, but the meaning of the metaphor is profound. And it's the same thing with last week, where we talked about the courtroom metaphor and that Jesus is our substitute, that there's a guilty verdict against humanity, against each one of us. As Paul puts it, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There is none that is righteous. No, not one, Paul says, quoting the Psalms. Guilty. And Jesus steps in and takes our place. He is declared guilty in our place. Now again, this is a metaphor. There is no literal courtroom where Jesus was declared guilty for me and for you and for every one of the other billions of human beings. That's not literally true. But the message and the impact is true, that we do not have to be afraid of guilt or punishment. That's true. That's what Jesus revealed on the cross through his death. Today is another piece of Paul's letter to the Romans. A whole bunch of Paul's letter to the Romans is taken up with kind of explaining the meaning of the gospel, which has the cross at its center. And in chapter 6, which was just read, Paul is talking about how is it that we are connected with Christ? How does that connection happen? And Paul uses what is clearly a metaphor. He says, we have been baptized into Christ's death. And he's using that metaphor, he's using that word baptism, because as you might recall, baptism in the early church was not like baptism in our tradition. In our tradition, we think of baptism, we think of an adorable baby, a little bit of water poured on his or her head, happy parents, happy grandparents. But that's not the way it was in the early church. The people that Paul was talking to that were baptized, they weren't baptized as infants, they were baptized as adults. And the way that they were baptized is they were taken out into the river and plunged under the water and then lifted back up. This was an experience of new life. You know, just like I said to the kids earlier, if you've been underwater and unable to breathe and you come up out of the water and you suck in that first lung full of air, that feels like life. And that's the image that that's in the background as Paul talks about this. So we're connected with Jesus in his death. And because we're connected with Jesus in his death, Jesus died to sin. We are dead to sin. He who is dead, Paul says, is freed from sin. We're freed from that. And that's the image that Paul wants to give us. But it's more than an image. That's the reality that Paul wants to convey. That we are in a different reality because of what Jesus did for us and because of our connection to Jesus. That it's not the way that it used to be. That, yes, are we still tempted? Yes, we are still tempted. Are we still going to do things that are wrong and hurtful? Yes, we sometimes will. But we are in a new place of freedom because of what Christ has done and because of our connection with Christ. So Paul says we have more options because of the cross, because of Jesus' death and resurrection. Reality has changed. That's what Paul is saying. Yes, he uses metaphors to describe it, but the metaphor points to a profound truth. And we can experience this in our own lives, especially over time. As we grow in our connection with God, as we grow in our realization of how deep God's love is for us, that enables and empowers us to live in ways that share that love with others, which steers us away from things that would be destructive to ourselves or harmful to other people. That change is real. That possibility is real. And that's what Paul is trying to communicate here. He's saying to the Romans and he's saying to us, look, I know that there's still a lot of evil in the world. I know that there's still a lot of temptation. I know that there are times where you still are going to go astray. But that's not the whole story. That's not the deeper story. That's not the truest reality. The deepest truth is that because we are connected with the death of Jesus, we are also connected with the life of Jesus. And that possibility for a different kind of life is there for us. And it's not just a possibility, but it's a promise. And we can live into that promise. Thanks be to God.
gifts and let them be filled with messages from me. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt
Turning our heads to God, who is gracious and merciful, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of life, bind your faithful people into one body, enliven the church with your spirit, and bless the work of those who work for its renewal. Accomplish your work of salvation in us and through us. For the sake of the world, hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of life, you love the world you have made, and you grieve when creation suffers. Restore polluted lands and waterways. Heal areas of the world ravaged by storms, floods, wildfires, droughts, and other natural disasters. Bring all things to new life. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of life, show redemption to all who watch and wait with eager expectation. Those longing for wars to cease, those waiting for immigration paperwork to finalize, those seeking election, and those in dire need of humanitarian relief. Come quickly with your hope. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of life, you weep with those who grieve. Unbind all who are held captive by anxiety, despair, or pain. Fill us with compassion and empathy for those who struggle, and keep us faithful in prayer. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of life, we give thanks for opportunities for this congregation to collaborate with our community in caring for the needs of our neighbors. Strengthen our ties with other local congregations, agencies, and services. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. At this time, other intercessions may be offered silently or aloud. God of life, you are our resurrection. We remember all those who have died and trust that in you they will live again. Breathe new life into our dry bones, that we, too, may live with you forever. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. According to your steadfast love, O God, hear these and all our prayers as we commend them to you. Try again. According to your steadfast love, O God, hear these and all our prayers as we commend them to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. If there is any way that I or anyone in your Trinity family can be helpful to you, please let me know. Likewise, if you are in a position to be helpful to others and you would like to volunteer, please let me know. If you would just like to keep in touch, please give me a call. It would be good to hear from you. You are all continually in my prayers, and I am eagerly looking forward to that day soon when things will be back to whatever the new normal will be. And now may Almighty God, who raised again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, bless you abundantly. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.